Okay, so we need to discuss what is bioenergetics. Bioenergetics is the study of energetic events in the biological world, and biological world in the second lecture will be the human body, and we're going to discuss how energy flows through the human body. And before we can discuss physiology and biology, we actually need to know a little bit about the physics of energy, and in terms of physical laws that we require to know, that would be the first law and the second law of thermodynamics. And the first law of thermodynamics states that energy cannot be created. So whatever energy we have in our human bodies, we've had to go out and get from somewhere else. We cannot create our own energy. The second law of thermodynamics states that energy tends to entropy. That means that energy always wants to go from somewhere where there's more of it to somewhere where there's less of it. It's sort of similar to water potential, whereby water during osmotic processes goes from somewhere with a high water potential to a low water potential. In the same way, you can think of this, of energy as moving from places where there's a high energy potential, where there's a lot of energy, to somewhere where there's lower energy potential, to somewhere where there's less of it. In other words, energy wants to spread out as a thin sheet throughout the universe. It does not want to be concentrated in blobs of sun and stars. It wants to escape the sun and stars or whatever is being produced and run free across the universe until all of the universe is in an even energy state, and that would be then the heat death of the universe, because heat can only be created as energy runs around from place to place. So the second law of thermodynamics states that energy wants to escape from places where there's a lot of it to places where there's less of it. And because of that, when we try and grab energy and convert that energy into methods that we can use it, a lot of that energy escapes in that process of conversion and escapes into the universe. It escapes the actual cell as heat, and that heat energy escapes our bodies and radiates into the atmosphere and eventually into the universe. And so in our own way, we are actually contributing, we are merely a bus stop on this journey that energy takes as it tries to evenly spread out through the universe. Now, what the body needs to do is first it needs to take energy and convert it into adenosine triphosphate. And then this adenosine triphosphate is available as fuel for the body. So first we take energy and convert it to adenosine triphosphate, and then the cellular mechanisms in our body that require energy will then take that adenosine triphosphate and extract energy from it. So you can think of that as being a two-step process, and at both steps, at each step of the process, there's a loss of energy escaping as heat. So in the end, we only actually are able to harness at best about 30% of the energy available in our food, and 60% ends up escaping as heat, as a sort of rough rule of thumb. Which brings us to the question, what is energy? And the short answer to that is that we don't really know what energy is. I've got this quote from Richard Feynman, which I got from the Wikipedia page on energy, and he said, it's important to realize that in physics, we have no knowledge of what energy is. In other words, we see what energy does, and we can see the effects of energy, but we've never seen energy directly. We've never measured energy directly. We've never caught a molecule of energy or a wave of energy or whatever it is and put it in our little, under the microscope or whatever, and had a good hard look at what it is. We don't have any definite sort of definition or picture of what is energy. So at best, we say that energy is an indirectly observed quantity that allows physical systems to perform work. So if a fire burns, we see that wood or charcoal is being converted into ash and gives off heat. So we think that energy is involved in that process. When a car moves forward or when you pick up a book, we see that there are physical things that are able to change position in time and space and alter the time and space around it. And that suggests that there must be something powering those processes in the background called energy. So that is the best definition we can get of energy. And we say that energy then allows physical systems to perform work, and then we need to make a definition of what is work. And depending on what branch of science you're involved in, you're going to have a different definition of what work is. Although if you had to be philosophical about it and you look at all the different definitions of work, ultimately they point sort of to the same thing. But for the sake of bioenergetics, we're going to keep it simple and stick to this one specific definition of work as displacement at a point of application. So let's explore that sort of more in depth. We said work as displacement and a point of application, and this work has to happen in the presence of energy. So energy is this mysterious thing that is present in our bodies, and it causes displacement. In other words, if you look at any chemical reaction in the human body or any sort of physical movement of the body, on a chemical level, there will always be some sort of chemical change in the molecules as displacement of the chemicals. Either a chemical has changed or it's made a new bond. Some alteration in its physical structure has occurred. And that's why I like that definition of work as being a displacement at a specific point. Because really, if you look at human processes at its most basic level, we'll see that there's usually some sort of chemical distortion or chemical, new chemical bond forming, or something happening, some alteration in a molecule, some change in structure or change in its positioning. And with that change in positioning, we then actually have our bodies accomplishing work. Another thing to note about energy is that it allows molecular components to stick inside a molecular form. For the power of energy, we can take two molecules and stick them together and form a new molecule. And we're going to explore that a little bit in depth in the following slides when we discuss the formation of adenosine triphosphate. So what does that mean for our bodies? We have ATP. Our ATP breaks down and releases energy. And at the specific point where energy is released, the molecules around that ATP are going to vibrate more, or they're going to distort in shape, or they're going to bump into other molecules, allowing for chemical reactions or molecular processes that we consider to be metabolism, that we consider to be part of being a living thing. And if there is no energy, then the molecules will tend to entropy. In other words, energy wants to spread out throughout the universe into a nice thin sheet that's impossible to harness, and our molecules will no longer be able to harness that energy, and they will break up, they want to spread apart, they will not react, they will not vibrate, they will be cold and non-dynamic. So if I suck all the energy out of your body, all the metabolic processes in your body are going to shut down, and life will cease. So life can be seen as an organized vibration and a chemical reaction system. So we have all these vibrating molecules in our body, and they're bumping into each other and distorting in shape all the time. They're reacting with one another all the time. And this thing that we call life is really the sum total of all these little reactions that are constantly being created in the presence of energy. And just to note that molecules require energy to exist, and if we break up a complex molecule, we're going to release energy, and that energy release is absorbed by the molecules around it, causing distortions and molecular vibrations, which is pretty much the modus operandi of ATP. So ATP, what is that? Well, ATP is a molecule from which energy can easily be released to do useful work in cellular systems. And we said that work is physical, is displacement at a specific point of application. So ATP is a molecule from which energy can be easily released to cause displacement of molecules at a specific point where required by cellular metabolic processes. And pretty much all life on Earth has become reliant on ATP. There are other molecules from which we can harness energy, but far and above all other processes, life on Earth has adapted to harnessing energy from ATP. And we take energy from nutrients, and we form ATP from adenosine diphosphate and inorganic phosphate. And energy from ATP is used to power biological processes by letting it degrade back into a constituent parts, back into ADP and inorganic phosphate. And that ADP inorganic phosphate bond in and of itself contains 7.3 kilocalories per mole of ATP. So whenever, if you have a mole of ATP and you let it degrade into ADP plus phosphate, you're going to have that much energy being released. Okay, so this is ATP, chemical level. This is a drawing I made. You'll notice all the drawings and flow diagrams in the slideshow are hand-drawn. The reason I've done that is because when I'm drawing the diagrams rather than cutting and pasting, I avoid violating anyone's copyright. So for copyright reasons, I decided to include just some of the hand drawings, and that makes it much more easier for me to distribute these notes. But this is ATP, and on this side we have something called adenosine. And adenosine consists of adenine, which is a purine molecule. It's one of the components of DNA. And we have a sugar here called ribose. And the sugar is basically just a carbon chain or carbon ring with some oxygen and hydrogen. So we've got a bit of DNA there and a bit of sugar there, and we've pumped it together to make adenosine. And this requires some energy to bind these molecules together, so we've already invested a little bit of energy into this molecule. And adenosine is also present naturally in the human body. It's an inhibitor molecule. So if you ever had a patient in an emergency unit with supraventricular tachycardia, you'll know from your ACLS course that supraventricular tachycardia, you can, if it's stable, you can treat by giving adenosine as a push intravenously, and the adenosine will then inhibit your cardiac conduction, and your heart rate might spontaneously go back to a normal rate and rhythm. Adenosine is also present in your brain, where it inhibits neural functioning. And next time you have your cup of coffee, remember that coffee, your caffeine, is an adenosine inhibitor. So by inhibiting the inhibitor, you feel more awake and more energetic. Anyway, we take this adenosine molecule, and the human body is then going to add an inorganic phosphate molecule. So phosphate is phosphorus with some oxygen and a hydroxide molecule. And we're going to invest even more energy into binding this inorganic phosphate with adenosine, and then we're going to have adenosine monophosphate. And then we're going to invest even more energy to add another phosphate group on top of this molecule. So now we're going to have adenosine diphosphate. Now remember that energy tends to entropy. Energy does not want to blob up into a supermolecule. It wants to escape into the universe and run free and wild and spread out evenly through the universe. So by forcing energy into these blobs, into these bonds, we're somewhat going against the second law of thermodynamics. So the more energy we invest into our molecule, the more likely that energy is going to want to deblob and run off and go free into the universe. So just bear that in mind. We're going to invest some more energy into this molecule and put another phosphate molecule to make ATP. And ATP is adenosine triphosphate. Now, because adenosine triphosphate has so much energy stored into it and so much energy that wants to escape into the universe, ATP tends to degrade. It doesn't degrade immediately, it lasts for a while. But if you take a whole sort of jar of ATP, chances in solution, chances are after a while it's going to completely degrade into ADP and inorganic phosphate. So this has some implications. The human body doesn't want to store too much ATP, because ATP that's not used will degrade. On the other hand, ADP is relatively stable and lasts a long time, so ADP the body can store without losing it too much to natural spontaneous degradation. Also, in a pinch, the human body can degrade ADP into AMP to release some energy in this bond. This bond does not contain as much energy as this bond, but the energy difference between these two bonds is so minutely, the difference is so minute that it's pretty much negligible. So we can break this bond and break this bond to release almost equal amounts of energy. Okay, so as mentioned, ATP degrades. It's also quite a heavy molecule, so it doesn't make sense for the body to store large amounts of this heavy molecule that can actually spontaneously degrade before you can even usefully use its energy. So the body only stores about 80 to 100 grams of ATP for immediate use. So the ATP, the body has to become quite creative and store ATP indirectly, and the way it stores ATP indirectly is through this phosphocreatine. So what happens is that there's a lot of phosphocreatine, especially in your muscle, and when necessary, your phosphocreatine is hydrolyzed, and then there's inorganic phosphate suddenly released, and this inorganic phosphate can combine with ADP immediately to form creatine and ATP. And this process luckily does not require oxygen, it's an anaerobic process. Unfortunately, this form of storage cannot maintain maximal effort for very long. Your phosphocreatine stores are pretty much used up within 5 to 8 seconds, closer to 5 if you're a sedentary person, closer to 8 if you're an athlete. And once your phosphocreatine stores are used up, you're going to have to use additional energy sources to keep yourself going. These energy sources being carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. And obviously, if your phosphocreatine is exhausted so quickly, your body must have the ability to switch between energy sources. So short bursts of maximum effort or exhaust your phosphocreatine, for example, where sustained activity is going to rather rely on breakdown of your energy sources for that long sustained output. Okay, so excluding that hydrolysis of phosphocreatine, there are two other steps we can use to make ATP. One is electrons transport, and the other step is phosphorylation. You can have either oxidative phosphorylation or substrate phosphorylation. Oxidative will be due to the movement of electrons, and when we have movement of electrons, we then have phosphorylation, whereby inorganic phosphate is bound to ADP to make ATP. Alternatively, we have an enzyme or substrate, which through an enzyme reaction combines the phosphate to ADP. And these processes are known as cellular oxidation because they rely on the donation of electrons to get the chemical process going. And every oxidation reaction, and as every donation reaction, requires a reduction reaction. In other words, some molecule that receives the electrons or accepts the electrons. So they're always paired, which is why often they'll be referred to as oxidative reduction reactions. And these processes occur within mitochondria, and what we have in mitochondria are these carrier molecules that remove electrons from hydrogens and give the electrons to oxygen. A hydrogen, remember, is a proton nuclear core with an electron surrounding it. So what happens is carrier molecules steal that electron from hydrogen to make a hydrogen ion, which is literally just a single charge, single positive charge, a single proton. So some textbooks will refer to protons rather than hydrogens. And then the electron is stolen from our proton and handed over to another proton present in the oxygen molecule. Okay, so as mentioned in the previous slide, the way we're going to harvest energy from electrons is that we're going to take electrons from hydrogen and we're going to donate them to oxygen. So let's explore that in a bit more detail. We're going to make ATP for electron transport, so we need electrons, and we're going to harvest that from hydrogen. The hydrogen in turn is harvested from the foods we eat. And what we have is we're going to see in detail later on in the slideshow how dehydrogenized enzymes release hydrogen from nutrients. And there are coenzymes involved, which in turn capture the electron when this hydrogen is released due to the action of the dehydrogenase. And the most common coenzyme is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, abbreviated as NAD, and there's usually a little positive charge, so it's a NAD plus. And adenine is our old friend, the DNA component, which is also found in adenosine. So here we see that this DNA component is also used as part of the coenzyme used to harvest electrons. Nicotinamide is vitamin B3, so what we have is a vitamin B3 and adenine that are plumped together to make this coenzyme NAD+. Nicotinamide is also considered to be a nucleotide, so we have one nucleotide, adenine is a nucleotide, and therefore we can bond them together to make a dinucleotide. And what happens is that when we oxidize nutrients, in other words we make them donate their electrons, NAD plus is the reducing molecule, and it harvests a hydrogen and two electrons directly into its structure, and is therefore reduced to NADH, and we harvest we have two electrons that we're harvesting, so there must be two hydrogens, so we then also end up having a hydrogen left over from this process. And in practice, these two molecules, NADH plus H plus, often work as a unit in metabolic processes. And the other big player in electron transport is flavin adenine dinucleotide, again made from a vitamin, specifically vitamin B2 or riboflavin, and the adenine molecules. And this is abbreviated as FAD. So flavin adenine dinucleotide harvests hydrogen as well, and accepts electrons and becomes FADH2. So rather than having that three protons attached in the equation, the proton binds to the flavin adenine dinucleotide. So let's assume we've harvested some electrons. I want to go into more detail on how we harvest electrons, especially in the citric acid cycle, the Krebs cycle, a bit later on in the slideshow. But for now, let's assume we've harvested the electrons, and now we need to do something with these electrons in order to make ATP. And what we're going to do is we're going to shuttle these electrons from an electron transport chain, and hopefully as the electrons bounce from station to station in this electron transport chain, we're going to release some energy and hopefully be able to convert that energy into ATP. So this process occurs in the mitochondria. We have mitochondrial cytochromes. These are complex sort of organic molecules consisting of iron and proteins, and they are the guys who accept the electrons and begin this process of an electron transport chain. And what happens is an electron passes along each station along this electron transport chain. And it's specifically the iron that allows us to move these electrons very easily. What happens is that the iron in the cytochrome molecules becomes oxidized, and as it accepts an electron, it becomes ferric, Fe3+, and then they have to easily donate the electron to become ferrous, Fe2+. And so the electrons basically bounce from iron molecule to iron molecule along this chain, and then as they bounce along the molecule, they activate hydrogen pumps. So we've harvested all these hydrogens, and we have all these protons, or all these hydrogen ions, left over from the harvesting of our electrons, and at several points in this electron transport chain, we're going to pump these protons from the inside of the mitochondria, the mitochondrial matrix, into the intermembrane space, between the outer and inner membranes of the mitochondria. And as these electrons bounce from cytochrome to cytochrome, eventually they're going to have a reduced sort of amount of energy. And then once they are sort of exhausted of their potential energy, they recombine with hydrogens, often from the very same hydrogens that they were harvested from. Plus you're going to need an oxygen ion to accept that electron, and hydrogen, oxygen, and these spent out electrons will make water, H2O. And ultimately, after the electrons have bounced along the chain, we're going to have a lot of hydrogen ions that have been pumped into the intermembrane space. We're going to have a positive charge on the one side because of all these hydrogen ions. And the difference in the electrical potential because of this gradient of charge is what we're going to use to create ATP.